at Ungender, what we decided to do was, of course, open the platform for people who have always been reaching out in our inboxes and through emails to ask us different questions related to Posh. And these are individuals who are HR leaders. These are individuals who are complainants, people who have either experienced workplace sexual harassment or they have experienced receiving a complaint against them for sexual harassment at workplace. The idea was to actually keep it open so that all of you can ask, but we also realized that this is such a sensitive topic that even if we keep it open, ask us anything and ask me anything, or it might not be a very comfortable forum where everyone is just watching it, for you to come out and for people to come out. So what we have decided to do instead is actually identify the common questions that we receive almost on an everyday basis from different members of the society when it comes to Posh Act 2013. And here I have with me Rituparna Chatterjee. And yes, of course, most of you know her as member of Ungender team, but majority of you would know her as somebody who has been, Ritu, you don't mind, spearheading the whole Me Too India movement and has actually taken it to a limelight and highlight, which otherwise for people across India would have ideally not been possible, because when we talk about anything from legal jargons or in a legal language, majority of the people do not really want to learn. They don't want to understand. So simplifying what it means, what workplace sexual harassment and these rights that have been introduced mean for each and every individual out there is something that needed very high or very basic level of simplification. And I'm glad, Ritu, you have done that, and it's been quite a journey to work alongside you at Ungender for this. So yes, let's take one by one the common questions that we hear.
Thank you so much, Falgi. That was a very generous way to describe that what we've all been doing since October 2018, when I think for a lot of us, the landscape of how we address workplace sexual harassment changed. And also what all the things that we suddenly found the language for many, many, many women, they've always encountered this, but they didn't have the language to express. I want to say that it's a survivor-led movement, so none of us really have spearheaded it. It's all, we call ourselves volunteers for this movement. And what we do, and the reason also why I'm here is, it's very important that one thing I've learned from the last 2 years is resource sharing. And that's something that you and at Ungender and we at Ungender constantly do, like in all across our work, all the work that we do, we are all about resource sharing with, the people we work with and the people we come across. So yes, this is great.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so Ritu, I think it's almost like spin the bottle. Your turn first. What's the most common question that people have approached you when it comes to their query on workplace sexual harassment?
I think that would have to be a general anonymity. Like, anonymity is such a big aspect of whether or not a person would even, sort of complain. Anonymity being one, and of course power being the second aspect of it. Power and of course retaliation. A lot of complaints have been lodged because people thought that they could anonymously reach out to NCW or anonymously reach out to, other arenas wherever they could find recourse for sexual harassment at the workplace. I have always had people come and ask me that, can I remain anonymous? Like, even with ICs, even if I'm hesitating to file a complaint, if I do, can I remain anonymous? So that's been the most common, because people fear, like women, especially women, fear retaliation. And that's that's the common thread. कि मेरे से मेरे पे क्या होगा, मैं तो कर दूंगी कंप्लेन, उसके बाद क्या होगा, अनसर्टेनिटी, यू नो,
बिकॉज़ यू हैव टू वर्क अलोंगसाइड दैट पर्सन ओनली, दे डोंट इवन नो, हाउ डू यू गो टू ऑफिस एंड वर्क अलोंगसाइड द सेम पर्सन, इट्स नॉट दैट एवरीबॉडी इज पार्ट ऑफ द लार्ज ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, सब लोग एक बहुत बड़ी कंपनीज में काम नहीं कर रहे हैं, कि एक एक टीम में क्या हुआ है, या उस पर्सन के अगेंस्ट अगर आपने कंप्लेन डाली है तो आप फिर भी अपना एक नॉर्मल वर्क रूटीन चला सकते हैं, तो वो सबके लिए पॉसिबल नहीं है, राइट? सो बट एनोनिमिटी इस लॉ के अंडर पॉसिबल नहीं है, तो व्हाट डू यू टेल देम रितु?
सो डिपेंड्स ऑन व्हाट बेसिकली वेयर दे वर्क एंड व्हाट सॉर्ट ऑफ वेयर द कंप्लेंट्स, लाइक इट ऑल डिपेंड्स ऑन व्हाट इज द प्लेटफॉर्म दे आर सीकिंग, बिकॉज़ टू बी वेरी ऑनेस्ट, if you say this in context of Me Too, only those people, you know, come to the people who are sharing resources after they're exhausted, like they do not want to do it by a they don't know what they don't want to do. But the moments are, I want to basically out the person, because I see in no way this person is going to get any retribution, like get any sort of penalty. The power equation is too, you know, too skewed. So most of it, the complaints that come are just seeking resources and how to sort of out a predator or how to sort of out a person when they find that all the like due processes have failed, which is why a lot of them took to the internet to talk about, because due processes completely failed them. But if it isn't in an official capacity, like in their workplace, so I found that most people have already gone through the HR route. The minute you've gone to your HR, like in a simple email saying that this has happened, that email is a complaint, will be taken as a complaint to the HR, and the HR instantly obviously routes it to the IC route, if the company has an IC. It is after the IC finishes the process, that's when they come and they're not happy with the outcome. And in most, I've found in many, many cases, women are not, because the IC no evidence, or the IC found the person not guilty of, you know, the transgressions that is mentioned. So that's when they sort of ask, what else? What else can we do? What is our recourse? Is that something you also get a lot?
Yes, anonymity related, very, very dedicated and direct question that we get is, can I file a complaint, and I don't need to tell the committee or the person who I am, right? Or can I request the committee, or can I request the HR, that without disclosing my identity, can you reach out to the respondent and just go ahead with the investigation? Sadly, the problem is that yes, there are fears and concerns with respect to disclosing one's identity. It's also against the law, right? In Bosch Act, it's been clearly mentioned, and I think they did it. I believe they did it to prevent any form of misuse. But it's clearly mentioned that if ever anybody wants to remain, you know, anonymous, no anonymous complaints can be entertained. And then it becomes the duty of the internal committee to ensure, why is a woman, as an aggrieved, scared, afraid of disclosing her identity? And that's when educating her about all their rights come into picture. But all these complaints or all these questions come from the woman. And then it becomes important to educate them that, hey, you learn first what your rights are, right? Go to your committee and ask them, how will you ensure that I will not face any retaliation? Because that's your number one concern. How do you expect me to work alongside the same person who I might have to meet on a day-to-day basis while there's a complaint that I have filed against them, right? So they should be able to address that. There are provisions in the law to take care of it. If you are concerned that other members of the organization will unnecessarily talk about it, you will become a topic of random gossip. right? Between workplaces where people are not occupied and there's time to do these kind of gossips, ensure that you tell your committee that it's your duty to make sure that everything that I'm speaking to you about here should not become a random conversation in the teams. So you go prepared to the committee and you tell them that I was concerned that if my identity is disclosed, then these three things can happen. But I got to know that it's your duty to ensure that. So do that and now tell me, how are you going to do that, right? So, but yes, disclosing identity is one of the most common thing. And then complementing it, what we get is, how will the committee ensure confidentiality, right? How will it make sure that everything that I'm talking to them about is something that will stay with them only and other members in my team will not get to know? Because it's sad that this reputational aspect of a woman when they're working in the team. So even if they are the ones who have experienced some misconduct, they are also the ones who are concerned about further shaming in the team.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. अच्छा इन्होंने इसके बारे में इस तरीके से कुछ बोला था, अरे पता है उसने इसके साथ ऐसा किया और इसने कंप्लेन फाइल कर दी. नो वन विल, द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ डिस्कशन विल नॉट बी द रिस्पोंडेंट, राइट? द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ डिस्कशन एज ऑलवेज विल बी द वन हु हैज गॉन थ्रू इट.
आल्सो यू स्पॉट द आयरनी इन दिस, लाइक सो इन स्पेशली इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ मी टू, एंड आई एवरी टाइम अ केस केम अप एंड आई वाज यू नो सॉर्ट ऑफ कॉन्फ्लिक्टेड बिकॉज when anybody tells a complainant that file, you know, why don't you go to the IC of your organization and, you know, talk about whatever you're talking about on social media. That's one way of seeking justice when due process fails, but also lodge like a IC, proper IC complaint. But there is no way now to guarantee anonymity. Yes, I think we dropped off at where I said that, you know, once you call out someone on the internet, right? And then do you feel that the option of due process instantly goes away because you can no longer file an IC complaint, which guarantees anonymity for both parties?
Huh, but why not? I mean, even if you have taken things out in public or on some social media or any other place. I mean, even when people have taken matters of workplace sexual harassment directly to high courts, even the high courts have sent them back to the company saying that there is a procedure internally set in place. Set up your IC and get them to look at it. And if either of the parties are not satisfied with the decision and the way investigation was done, then bring it to our level, right? But I hear you when you say that the concept of anonymity completely goes away if things are there. And that's something that the committee has to consider also. And individuals have to consider. I mean, if everybody knows, then how do you even go about identifying who leaked what information and where did, you know, how did everyone else get to know? But major concern for confidentiality, even in companies. So what we always tell individuals, whoever reach out to us, either complainant or respondent, that now everyone in the organization knows. And especially, I've heard this mainly coming from women as complainant, but at the same time, even men who have been accused of workplace sexual harassment have reached out with similar concern because their identity was not kept confidential. Right, and it is something that they need to know, that when we talk about this IC procedure, everyone's identity has to be kept confidential, including the witnesses.
The law protects everyone until you're found guilty.
Yeah, even after, Ritu.
After, actually.
Right? You can't be... See, there's also a public trial, right? And same thing happens in the companies also. So if you know that I have been accused of something and I have been proven guilty of it also, and there are already consequences that the committee has created for me, but at the same time, if you also start treating me differently, that's also additional punishment. and the consequence of it, which is exactly what the law is preventing, that there is one committee which has been appointed to make the decision, and anything that they decide will be the consequence or the punishment, whatever the decision may be. But other than that, no other member in the organization has any right to create consequences for either of the parties, even if they have filed a complaint or even if there's a complaint that has been filed against them, right? Either way, same thing for the witnesses. The same protection should be there for them. So that's another one. One more that we hear, and let me know if you also hear it, is that who will represent me, right? Can I bring a lawyer or should I bring a lawyer, right? Both the things. Has this question come to you also?
Of course. And the most, like, you know, why the first thing we did at that time, a lot of people were pooling in, is to create a list of pro bono lawyers because of the fear of, you know, retribution and the fear of being taken to court on charges of defamation. So, of course, there were very many different kinds of complaint, ranging from sexual harassment to assault to, you know, cyber crimes, the whole range. But yes, legal protection, the right to legal representation is something that constantly came up. And also, would I need a lawyer to even take to my IC, and, you know, what sort of evidence do I need? Because most of these incidents, majority percentage has happened behind closed door with no evidential, you know, sort of, and as you know, sexual harassment mostly happens behind closed doors. So you don't take a phone, like, it's impromptu, it's spontaneous. You don't always record on camera unless it's textual harassment where you can prove a chain of, you know, transgressions. But molestation and all of this different kind of, mostly there's no eyewitness. So that has been like another like area of discomfort and area of constant like confusion. How do I prove?
Yeah, no, that is true. That is true. What I have heard this question coming, sorry, I have to move. What I have heard this question coming mostly is in the context of, see, it is a legal process at the end of the day, right? And people have to present their case. People have to tell some members of the committee what happened, more details, if they have evidence, if they have witness. The whole jargon, cross-examination and investigation, all these are such heavy things. And as it is, somebody is aggrieved, and then let's just suppose that the organization is also not invested in educating them, right? We have seen a lot of companies wherein they have educated their members, their employees, in a full-fledged manner, telling them very clearly how the process will go, how much time will it take, what are their rights, sharing documentation in a very, you know, proactive manner. Also disclosing everything with them, making sure things are fair and transparent. The problem is this fear mostly happens when they have not been made aware properly, or they have not been educated properly. And this is so common. Every time a person has come looking for a lawyer, the first thing that we have asked them is, have you not received this briefing from your committee? Because the ideal thing is, when you reach out to a complainant, or when a complainant reaches out to you, or a respondent, when you're reaching out to them, telling them that there's a complaint that we have received against you, you have to make sure that you tell them what their rights are. You have to tell them how the process will go. You have to tell them that there will be all possible assistance that will be given to them. That's the job of committee. Members have gone around looking for this kind of information, have reached out to somebody like me, somebody like you, Anjender, in our individual as well as professional capacity. That means that organization and that internal committee failed to do the preliminary job of communication, proper communication. And this is once again, they're right. They should be going back to them and asking them, why waste money on a lawyer? You don't need a lawyer. It's clearly written that no parties should be represented by a lawyer, mainly because this was the reason why this law was introduced. Right? This was the reason why this law ensured that if ever a woman will go through workplace sexual harassment, it's highly unlikely that she will approach the court. Right? Because first she'll have to go to the police, then she'll have to go to the court, going alone, running around courtrooms, finding a proper legal representative, checking their fees, being able to pay that fees. How many women will actually take that kind of decision? And if they will go to their families, it's actually not going to be a very supportive one. And that's why women did not used to complain about workplace sexual harassment. So one of the things that this law introduced was no parties should be represented by a lawyer, which means that they're all representing themselves. In order to represent yourself, you need to have proper education and awareness of what your rights are, which companies are supposed to do. So if the companies fail, that's when they come for people, come and ask these questions, people like us. So yeah, that's the response that we tell them. You don't need a lawyer.
Yeah, the sheer number of people who do not know their rights, like I'm not even going into the details of Posh. I'm just going into the very fact that when you ask people, does your organization have a Posh, like IC, have an IC, or do you know who the members are? Often they're blind because I don't think at the time of orientation, either people are given a gender sensitivity training or a sexual, anti-sexual harassment or a sexual harassment prevention training. None of that, I think, is done. And all this, when you see these companies saying that you're Posh compliant, you're this compliant, that compliant. And I just want to ask them, like, why ask your employees if they even know you're Posh compliant? If you're, that's a tag, that's a tick mark your employee should give you, that you're Posh compliant.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Another common query that comes up is fear of losing their job.
Oh my God, yes.
What if I file a complaint and I lose my job? What if they will fire me?
This coupled with usually the performance approval, performance rating, all the time that, you know, and it works both ways actually. So the one thing is that I have, you know, filed a complaint and soon following that, I've been given a very poor performance rating and been put on like performance review saying that your work has been consistently bad. And I also hear the reverse that because we gave her a poor performance rating, this is the, you know, the following thing is a sexual harassment.
Right, right.
I've heard both actually.
Same here.
This is a very gray, this is a very, very gray area where, you know, because often they coincide. Is that what your experience has been also?
It happens most of the, say, definitely, right? There are so many companies out there who would not want to have a troublemaker, right? See, the point is that the minute you're objecting about somebody giving you random compliments, somebody asking you too many personal questions, somebody not liking the inappropriate as well as, forget inappropriate, unnecessary physical contact, somebody not blending into the you know, so-called set culture or trying to change the way things have been around, the first thing that people will do is, we don't need a person like this, right? And to be honest, until and unless this law came in, nothing stopped companies from firing a troublemaker. And it's not us who call them troublemaker. They are considered troublemaker in the eyes of the companies. So it used to happen a lot. I know so many stories of 20 years old, 30 years old, wherein those women actually took the companies to the court. And surprisingly, some cases are still ongoing. Still ongoing, right? So one thing that this law took care of was saying that you cannot fire, a person cannot be fired or relieved from the job during an ongoing investigation or any connection which can be made with the complaint that they have filed. So if I have filed a complaint till the time there's a proper redressal, you can send me on paid leave, you can send me on suspension, you can do so many things, but you cannot fire me, you cannot relieve me from the organization. At the same time, even after, let's say the decision has been taken, whatever it was, proven, not proven, even after that, if the company thinks that, okay, now that the legal requirement is over and now we can get rid of this person, if I as a woman, as a complainant, can connect these two dots, because why, if my performance is good, why would a company suddenly decide to get rid of me for no reason, right? So if there is that kind of connect, that also is in violation of the POSH Act.
Yeah.
Both the things. You cannot fire a person during an ongoing investigation, and you also cannot fire a person because of a complaint that they had filed, right? And this is a form of retaliation. The second aspect is a form of retaliation, actually. And that's what this law was intending for, that even if a woman has filed a complaint, she should not face any form of retaliation as a result of it. Once again, trying to instill her faith in the system that companies have been given this responsibility that they will take care of their safety and prevent any form of workplace harassment. And if ever they fail, they will ensure that their career continuity exists in that same team. So that's what we tell, and that's what exists in the law.
Very interestingly, that, you know, because I just can't not mention this, the problem of bias. So recently I had a very interesting conversation with somebody who had approached for
they will ensure
asking for a IC recommendation, and was giving me a brief of what has happened. And at the end of that conversation, I was asked, but he has a huge reputation and is an asset to the team. If he is found guilty, do we have to sack him? I am often speechless at this, and I asked, like, if he's found guilty, it's on your conscience then to, if you're saying this yourself, if he's found guilty, then you fill in the blank after what you think is a suitable, penalty for this person. He's like, no, but the minute someone says no, but he is such a valuable asset to the team, it's such a bias. And I know for a fact that this person can be an IC member, like can be the chairperson of the IC. So this inherent bias towards, especially towards men, I'm sure that this works both gender ways, but towards men who've been accused, especially it's a senior person, how do you sort of, is it training, IC training?
It's not IC training, it's the leadership training that we need to take care of, right? Somewhere, no matter what happens, Ritu, we have seen enough number of cases within the team, not internally, but as we see, the kind of cases that we handle. Everything has to be taken as a stance from the leadership, saying that if you are given this authority to work independently and I as a leadership, as a team, is not supposed to meddle in it, then here are the three things that I want to tell you, right? From a leader to an IC, that follow the rule of the law, whatever it says, just follow that. Number two, don't worry about the impact on the business, because as long as you're following the law, the impact on the business will always be positive. Not the short-term gains that, somebody who was very important, we were able to retain them. What do you do with somebody retaining somebody who was important, who is also a sexual harasser?
Exactly.
So that person, right? In the long term, it's not going to be benefiting the business. So number one, follow the rule of the law. Number two, don't worry about the business. And number three, completely stay unbiased, neutral, impartial, transparent, and as diligent as you can when you're investigating a particular case, right? Just these three things, if a leader can actually say with a complete sincerity to their IC members, nobody actually has to worry about anything, right? But the leader needs to say this to their team, and the leader needs to say this to their IC, right? Because both of them need to hear it from them and not from anybody else. That's why we have seen that a lot of team members, a lot of employees, women, even if we tell them that, don't worry, nobody can fire you, this is your right, they don't believe it because they have not heard it from their company.
Right.
And they need to listen to them. Sorry?
There's no way to guarantee that as well. Like, we can tell them all we want, but you don't know how the company is going to react.
Exactly. So it usually boils down to the leadership only. And yes, of course, like I said, it starts with them, it ends with them, it stays with them. Everybody else is just a temporary figure in everything else. So yeah, these are the four common
questions. Can I ask one question though to you?
Yes. Oh, you want to ask me a question? Yes, please.
There's literally no data, no recent data on sexual harassment at workplace in India, right? There's of course anecdotal instances and evidences, but like figures. So, which means that sexual harassment cases are being massively underreported.
Yes.
Yeah. And at the end of the year, when you file the annual compliance report, you also have to show, you know, how you fared in how many complaints lodged. So why do you think this gap is there? Because see, logically there should be data because it's being reported to the ministry. So where is this data going? Why is nobody tracking it? Which brings us to our agenda.
So let's understand what's happening, Ritu. Okay. One, companies are required to create this report and submit it to the district officers.
Okay.
Even till today in 2020, okay, and we will be entering 2021 very soon, which means that, and companies are required to file a report in January of 2021 for this year. Even in 2021, companies would still not have a very clear understanding in any sense where that district officer is. Where do they sit? What is the format of the report? What should be included in the report? Who should be preparing the report? Who will be signing the report? We have to remember that signing a government document and a legal compliance document also calls for severe consequences. That means today, if I have signed a paper, that means someday whenever somebody has to check that, oh, whatever has been submitted actually was not the truth or the fact at that point in time, I'll be the one who will be called in, right? So who is going to sign this document is also something that people do not know. Then where to send it? Should we email it or should we courier it? Should we hand deliver it? I have seen companies who have hand delivered it and have lost the receipt of the submission. Okay, now in the absence of a receipt of a submission, what is happening in the back end offices? Okay, these are not emails. Okay, these are envelopes which are delivered. Okay, now imagine in any district, if companies, each and every company who has formed an IC has to submit this. Okay, what does it mean? That means, imagine you are the district officer and you have a district, you have your office, and then there are thousands and thousands of envelopes which are coming to you, telling you, maybe they're telling you that this is a posh compliance report, maybe they're not telling you. Just by looking at the envelope, there's no way for you to know. So that means that we have to rely on the system that somewhere in the office of the DO, district officer, somebody is opening all those envelopes and putting this data in an Excel sheet or some database. Okay, now I can't imagine that this is actually happening, but if it is happening, great.
Yeah.
If it is happening, great, but I can't imagine that this is happening in each and every district of this country. So until and unless this is what is happening, the other wishful thinking would be that the district officers are not collecting it. So they're collecting all these envelopes, packages that they have received, and they're being delivered, let's say, to the Department of Women and Child Development of that state. Then this means that somebody sitting in that office and now opening all the envelopes that have been received from all these districts of that one state and still putting it in some database. I don't know if that is happening. Nobody knows if that is happening.
So tracking, there's a whole tracking process is so fascinating. There's people, more people should know this actually. Like what really happens at the end of the life, the entire life cycle of a complaint actually. This is fascinating. Yeah.
And because it's not there, the data that you're asking for, okay, it exists somewhere. Okay, the data exists somewhere. The problem is it does not exist in one consolidated way. So today, if I have to write, like for the past couple of years, we have been constantly filing RTIs to receive the status of implementation on FOSH Act. So we are doing it again. It's really troubling us that how do we check with them that what is the number of complaints or how many companies have filed? Because then our assumption is that they have that Excel sheet or some system wherein they will just see that, oh, for year 18, 19, you know, how many companies submitted their ACR and tuck, 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 one, this sheet will open and they will say, oh, this is the total number. Wishful thinking. I hope this surprises us. I really hope this surprises us. But right now, if you want to know how many companies in this country right now, actually, as per the law, are submitting their annual compliance report, for somebody like you and me, there's no way to know. There is no way to know. So the only thing that we can do is maybe go to MCA website and see under the director's report how many of them have filed the declaration. Okay. Or what else can we do? Same thing with SEBI also. We can check it there also. So other than these two things, actually, there's no other way for anybody to know right now how many companies have actually filed annual compliance report. And the worst thing is, you don't have a comparison. So you can't say 8 out of 10 companies in this country right now have filed. So whenever some report comes out that says, let's say 38% of Indian companies are compliant with POSH Act, that's actually a flawed number. Because first and foremost, we need to understand this law is applicable to every workplace. Sports institutions, manufacturing segments, voluntary organizations, NGOs, companies, LLPs, anything and everything, schools, colleges, mills, unorganized
sectors. The workplace this law applies.
We don't even know how the number of workplaces in India right now. Do we know the number of workplaces? We have no idea. Right. So whenever these numbers come out that these many percentage of Indian workplaces are compliant with POSH Act, it's a complete bullshit. Okay, we don't even know what the X is, and now we are saying 10 out of X is compliant. That doesn't exist. So anyway, it's depressing when you think about it, because you also do not know how to track the progress. The only good thing is there's so many POSH practitioners out there now, which is a positive sign. That means that there are more companies who are looking for POSH practitioners. Like 7 years ago when we started, when you will tell somebody, you know, you have to comply with POSH Act, they will say, what? POSH what? POSH Act? Right? But now you say POSH Act, POSH compliance, and people get it.
People get it, yeah. Especially HR and it's...
Yeah.
True. So let's hope we'll get there.
Okay, people are saying hi and all, but nobody's asking a question. This topic requires more anonymity in conversation also.
True.
We'll take care of it. We have to find a way to create anonymous conversation even like this. We'll do that. Thank you so much, everyone who is watching. Thank you so much, everyone who will be watching.
We'll take questions in advance.
Sending questions. Yes, we'll take questions in advance. Anyway, I think we're always receiving questions in advance. There are more questions that come on DM and over phone calls than questions that come in live sessions, which is actually not surprising considering that we ourselves were talking about people keeping things confidential and keeping anonymity.
Seeking anonymity, yeah. Yeah, true.
Yeah. So great. Thanks everyone for joining us on a Wednesday evening. Look forward to hearing and staying with all of you. Stay inclusive, stay diverse, stay safe, and bye from both of us, from Anjender.
This is lovely.